Afternoon. Want to welcome you all. We're glad that you're here. Wow, what a turnout. Brett, you're popular. So we're just really honored to have you. On behalf of the Presbytery of the West, I want to welcome all of you. This is a service of the Presbytery, and the commission that the Presbytery has elected is composed of teaching elder Cliff Mansley, ruling elder Tim Tunnell, Barb Conti, Joyce Watson, Dave Holbert, and we have an ecumenical representative in the Reverend Bob Simmons, father-in-law, and also Nathaniel Everett, son. So it's a great team, and we're all honored to be here and be part of that. So welcome, and let us join together by standing and participating in the call to worship, if you're able. Almighty God, we are gathered here today to worship, celebrate, and respond to your call upon our lives. We have come to reaffirm our own callings, to remember your call to each of us. May our hands reach out in the cause of love and justice.
May our hearts rejoice in service of reconciliation.
And may our spirits unite with your spirit as we honor you with our lives. Let us pray. God of grace, you have given us minds to know you, hearts to love you, and voices to sing your praise. Fill us with your spirit, that we may celebrate your glory and worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us join together in our opening hymn, The Church is One Foundation.
Thank you. Please remain standing for the affirmation of faith and join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Please join me in the prayer of confession as found in your bulletin. Merciful Father, with contrite and humble hearts, we confess that we have too often forgotten we are yours. We carry on our lives as if there was no God and fall short of being a credible witness to you. For these things we ask your forgiveness. Give us clear minds and open hearts that may witness to you in our world. Remind us to be who you have called us to be, regardless of who we are, with, and what we are doing. Grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Now hear the assurance of pardon as found in 2 Corinthians. If anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. Therefore, let us assure one another of God's pardon. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray the prayer of illumination. Spirit of God, speak once again through the words of Scripture, that our listening ears may hear your voice. Help us to place your word in our minds. Treasure it in our hearts. Choose it with our wills and live it through our bodies. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from the book of Mark, the first chapter, verses 16 through 20. Christ begins the call of his first disciples. Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little further, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat, mending their nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father, Zebedee, in the boat with the hired servants and followed him.
Please pray with me. Almighty and ever-loving God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, hear our prayers for this congregation, our community, and the world. Thank you for allowing us to gather as your people to offer our prayers and our thanks to you for your call on Pastor Brett's life as we celebrate his installation as Associate Pastor of Desert Hills Presbyterian Church. Today we ask you to bless Pastor Brett, who has declared his willingness to humbly follow in the footsteps of Jesus by serving this congregation and our community. Continue to instill within Pastor Brett's family the undeniable faith and joy in you, binding them together as part of our Christian family. Thank you for the position you have given to all pastors around the world. Thank you for trusting them with your word. Thank you for their wives and families who support, love, and serve them. Protect them from every enemy, both known and unknown. We thank you for the various and creative ways you have called each one of us to participate with you in establishing your kingdom here on earth. Help us to see our vocations as advancing your holy and sacred work in this world. You give us hope when our souls yearn for comfort. You never leave us or forsake us. You are a God who keeps his promises. You, O Lord, are faithful, and your love and care for us never ceases. Lord, help us to remember that although we feel our burdens are heavy and many, we don't carry them alone. Teach us not to question your authority, but instead rely on your healing hand and your gifts of love, grace, and mercy to bring peace to this world, our homes, and our hearts. Forgive us, Lord, for being so busy with our earthly concerns that we overlook the many ways you reveal yourself to us. And forgive us for being so consumed and mindful of our own lives that we miss the many needs of those around us. We pray for those who are experiencing loss in any form. Be with the grieving. Cover them in your mercy and grace so that they feel supported by your divine love. We pray for those who provide care for family members and friends. May they feel your loving hand and your sustaining, nurturing power. May they feel less frustrated and experience less guilt for the very human feelings they may have and their desire to lessen their burdens. May they find in this church body eager to support them during their trials. Heavenly Father, we pray for the many who are hurting in the world. We ask for your tender love to sustain them. Be with the sick that they may find hope in your promise of everlasting life. We pray for the leaders of the world to understand that we all stand on common ground, that this world is your creation and not our possession. Please give them wisdom, discernment, and deep compassion for the decisions they make. As we head into this week, transform us all to be of one heart and one mind within your holy church, in the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our second scripture reading for this evening is found in the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 16 through 20, the Great Commission. Hear now the word of the Lord. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand and join me in our hymn, "Open My Eyes That I May See."
Please hear now a reading from the book of Acts, the first chapter, verses 1 through 8. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented him to them and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria to the ends of the earth." The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. We Presbyterians, we're a special lot, aren't we? We've been referred to by some as God's frozen chosen. Have you heard that? Well, you know, I found a biblical answer for that. I want you to know that the New Testament tells us that when Jesus comes back, we Presbyterians will be the first ones raised. Did you know that? Oh, it's very clear. The Apostle Paul says that when Jesus Christ comes back, the dead in Christ will rise first. Well, a lot of our Christian friends like to call us the frozen chosen. I blame it on Scotland. Scotland gave us the Presbyterian Church and gave us golf, and they're both frustrating, aren't they? But we love them both. When Kathleen Harris called me and invited me to be a part of this wonderful service in this wonderful congregation that I have admired since I heard about you in the year 2001, when I moved here into the valley and became pastor of the Goodyear Presbyterian Church, I had great respect for your pastors here and the church here. I was so honored, and I told her, I said, Kathleen, please know how honored and how privileged I feel to be able to participate in this service. So I want to thank Pastor Jim. I want to thank the session. I want to thank the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. And I want to thank all of you for allowing me to share in this very special moment in Brett's life, in your life. I'm going to take my cue to preach to you this afternoon from something the Apostle Peter did. Now, that can sound dangerous because, as you know, Peter is one of those disciples who was always opening his mouth and inserting his foot. But when he wrote the two letters that we have in our New Testament, 1st and 2nd Peter, in 2nd Peter chapter 3 and verse 1, he tells them what he was intending to say to them when he wrote those two books. And I want you to hear how he says it. He says it this way. Now, this is my second letter. This is in 2 Peter chapter 3. This is my second letter that I'm writing to you, beloved. And in both of them, I am stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder. That's from the ESV. The New Living Translation, now not the New Living Bible, but the New Living Translation translates that verse this way. Peter says to them, this is my second letter to you, dear friends. And in both of them, I have tried to stimulate your wholesome thinking and refresh your memory. That's what I want to do here this afternoon. I want to speak to you on the topic called and equipped. I'm going to hazard a guess. I can be wrong with this guess, but I'm going to guess that because we're here to install an associate pastor, that when I say to you, I'm going to talk about the called and equipped, your mind went to the clergy. Because Pastor Jim and Cliff and Pastor Brett and any other pastors that may be here certainly fit into that category. They are the called, they have been set apart by God, and they have been equipped to serve you. But that's only half of the story. Because what I want to remind you of this afternoon is that you too have been called and equipped to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. I was thrilled when I read with you the call to worship. Did you catch it in there? The call to worship even said to us that all of us are called. And so let me share with you, by way of reminding you of five great truths that is not new information to you. You've heard these five things before, but these are five great truths that we Christians, and I know this from an experience of being a pastor for over 50 years. I know you're wondering how such a young man could serve a church for 50 years. But my experience has been that we have a tendency to think that the called and the equipped among us are our pastors, our elders, our deacons, and that's it. So let me share with you five truths you must not forget, because it's so easy to forget these things. Number one, you every single one of you who know Jesus, every person here who is a follower of Jesus, you have the call of God upon you. Now, when you talk about the call of God, you can analyze it in three dimensions. There's three aspects to the call of God. The first is what we call the general call. That happens every Sunday when your pastors stand here and proclaim the glorious gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the call goes out, whosoever will may come. And there are those by the hundreds across this land of ours who hear such a call, but they get up out of their seats and they go home, not having yielded or submitted or surrendering to that call. It's called a general call because we invite everyone to come to Jesus, but you know and I know not everyone comes. But the second aspect of the call is what we call the effectual call. Effectual call means that the call goes out and it's heard in myriads of ways. It reaches into our hearts and into our minds, and we hear Jesus saying to us, come to me. I will forgive you of your sins. I will transform you. I will make you new. Come. We heard that call. We came to him in myriads of ways. I've often said to people, got to be careful with this, but I've often said to people, there are many roads to Jesus, but only one road to heaven, and that's Jesus. But we all come to Jesus through different paths. If I were to tell you how I came to Christ, it would be probably radically different from the way you came to Christ. But the point is this, if you've come to Jesus, you heard that call and you came because it's effectual. And that's why I had us read that very first passage from Mark, because we have the effectual call right before us in the story of the calling of the disciples. When Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee and he said to those fishermen, come follow me. What was the response? They left their nets, they left their father, and they follow Jesus, effectual. Now there's a third aspect to the call that sometimes gets lost, but we can't let it. And that is, there's the call to service, to work for Jesus. And it's right there in the Mark passage, because Jesus said to those fishermen, come follow me, and I will make you to fish for people. See, there's work involved. And so when you and I hear that effectual call that brought us to Christ and we experience redemption, salvation, forgiveness of sins, we must never forget that it's the same call that says, now that I'm following Jesus, he has work for me to do. And so, dear friends, you have the call of God upon you. You've come to him. He has work for you to do wherever you are. Now, the call is important to us because it's very clear. We know what it is we need to do. We come to Jesus. And it's compelling in the sense of once we've heard that call and we've responded by the grace of God to it, it just won't let us go. We can try to get rid of it. We can try to release it. But we can't. And it's an anchor to our souls, because when we know that we've heard the call of God, no matter what comes our way, we can't quit. I don't know about your pastors, but in my time of serving actively, in 50 years, I probably decided to quit 20 times. I couldn't. And I couldn't because of the call. Let me tell you a second thing you must never forget. You have all the authority of Jesus Christ behind you. That's our passage from Matthew. Jesus had resurrected. He was with his disciples 40 days. This is a part of that 40-day period in Matthew 28. And he meets with his disciples, and the very first thing he says to them is, all authority in heaven and on earth is mine. Therefore, I'm sending you out. Go. You see, authority is very important. And when you and I go to share our faith, when you and I go to lead a small group Bible study, when you and I go to serve as greeters or ushers or sing in the choir or do whatever it is God calls us to do, we do it not first and primarily because Desert Hills Presbyterian Church gave us the authority to do it, and not just because the EPC denomination gave us the authority to do it. Those two are involved, but we do them because we're under the authority of Jesus. Authority is very, very important. We don't get much in life done without authority. Think about it. Now, this is a homey illustration I'm going to give you, but I hope you get the point. Let's just suppose after the service today and after we've had our coffee and we've eaten Hannah's cookies, we go to our cars and we begin to make our way home, and I'm following one of you, and I begin to flash my lights. And you recognize it's me. And you say to your spouse there, hey, I think Bob is trying to get my attention. He's flashing his lights, honking his horn. So you pull over and I pull over. And I come up beside you and you let the window down and I say, you know, you're speeding. And I just feel my duty is to write you a ticket. Now, if your sanctification is secure, you will look at me kindly and say, Bob, that's really funny. Get in your car. I'm going home. If it's not, you might say some other nasty things to me. And the reason is very clear. I have no authority to do that. But let a person in the proper uniform and the badge on and a car that has the insignia on the side, and a little blue and red light, let him turn the lights on and flash the lights and pull you over. Your demeanor and your response is totally different. What's the difference? Is he better looking than me? Maybe. Is he smarter than me? Probably. That's not the difference. The difference is he has the authority to do it. And when you and I scatter from this place today and every Sunday, and we go to the places where God sends us throughout our week, and we live our life for Jesus, and we speak up for Jesus, and we give a witness for Jesus, and we're involved in ministry for Jesus, we're doing it with the authority of Jesus Christ behind us. Let me tell you a third thing that I want to remind you of. You have the power of the Holy Spirit within you. That's from our Acts passage that I just read a few moments ago. Jesus said to his disciples, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will receive power. That word power is a pretty dynamic word. In the Greek, it's the word from which we get the word dynamite. Did you know you have heaven's dynamite resident in you? Now, maybe you're sitting there this afternoon, you're saying, well, wait a minute, Bob. Jesus said when the Holy Spirit comes upon them, they will have power. I'm not sure. Has the Holy Spirit come upon me? And how can I be sure that the Holy Spirit has come upon? Let me put you at rest about that. Do you belong to Jesus? And if you belong to Jesus and you say, yes, I belong to Jesus, I've heard that effectual call. I've come to him. He's poured his grace in my life. He's forgiven me of my sins. I am a child of God. Then you have the Holy Spirit in you. Because St. Paul says in Romans chapter 8, he who does not have the Spirit does not belong to him. Which means that if you and I have the Spirit. We belong to Jesus. And in having the Spirit in our life, we have the power to do it. And when you read your New Testament, you do recognize, don't you, that it was the power of God, of the Holy Spirit, that overshadowed Mary and produced the virgin birth? That's power. Did you know that was the Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead? And the Bible goes on to say that the Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead will raise your mortal bodies. That power is resident within you. And I just got to be honest with you. Oftentimes we Christians, and it goes for us pastors too, oftentimes we don't experience that power because we're not in a place where we need that power. Do you understand what I'm saying? Let me put it to you this way. How much power do you need on Sunday morning to get out of bed, take a shower, get dressed, and come to church? Not a lot. But how much power do you need to have when you're having coffee with that friend to open your mouth and tell them about Jesus? Oh, you need a lot. And when you're in situations where God has put you to be of service for Him, that power will be released in you, I promise. You have the call of God on you. You have the authority of Jesus Christ behind you. You have the power of the Holy Spirit within you. Let me give you another reminder. You have the mission of Jesus in front of you. Matthew, the Great Commission passage that Nathaniel read for us a few moments ago, where Jesus said to the disciples, make disciples. That's our mission. Sometimes when you read this, and I have to confess, in the early days of my Christian life, when I first started reading the Bible, I thought the emphasis of the Great Commission was on go. It's not. You know why? They were ready to go. They had experienced the resurrected Christ. They wanted to go and tell the world all about Him, but Jesus knew they weren't fully equipped yet. And so He said, no, don't go anywhere just yet. Hold your horses. You wait in Jerusalem until the promise that I'm giving to you now comes upon you. And when that power comes upon you, open the doors and get going. Now, you and I don't have to have that delay as they did, because they were waiting on the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. You and I don't have to, because in the very moment we give our lives to Christ, the Holy Spirit invades us and releases His power and sends us out into mission. So what is your mission? It's clear. You don't have to struggle over this. You don't have to debate this. You don't have to argue over this. Your mission, the church's mission in America, regardless of the denomination, is make disciples. How do you do that? That's up to you. That part is up to you. You can come up with the methods and the procedures and the manners to go about in doing that. But listen to me carefully, a word of caution. This comes from a pastor's heart of compassion. While the mission is clear, and you can use any methods for doing that mission that produces disciples, churches who love their methods more than they love mission are in trouble. Now, I don't think you got that, so I want to say it one more time, can I? Churches that love their methods more than they love the mission are in trouble and will not survive. It's not our methods. Many, many years ago, this is outdated now, but you'll get the point. Many, many years ago, there was a laundry soap company that changed their box, their package. And their advertisement, I thought, was pretty neat, and it applies to what I'm saying to you now. They came out and they showed the new package and they said, our product was so good, we didn't tamper with it. We just changed the package. That's for us. Our product is clear. We don't tamper with the gospel. We give it to people and we make disciples, but we may package it in any way that will help us to be successful. One more and I'm done. One more reminder. You have the presence of Jesus beside you. When Jesus gave the Great Commission, he finished it by saying this, "I will be with you always, even to the end of the age." Do you believe that? Do you really believe? I mean, honestly, down deep in your gut, that Jesus is there with you. Beside, he said he was. In fact, in another passage, he said, "I will never leave you. I will never forsake." Do you believe that? I believe you do believe that. So let me ask you these follow-up questions. What would your life look like if we truly started taking it serious, that everywhere I went and everything I did, Jesus was right there beside me? Let me ask you this question. What would your church look like if we as a community, a body of believers, truly believed that Jesus is right here in our midst? He's here today. He's right here, present with us. Did you know that? That's what he said. I believe that. And so, my friends, I stir up your sincere minds by way of remembering the call of God is upon you. The authority of Jesus Christ is behind you. The power of the Holy Spirit is within you. The mission of God is before you. The presence of Jesus is beside you. Let's go get him. Amen. Would you pray with me? Come, Holy Spirit, and set our hearts on fire. Come, Holy Spirit, and set our church on fire. Come, Holy Spirit, and be glorified and honored in what we do and what we say as a part of the Desert Hills Presbyterian Church. And may we make an impact, not for our own honor and glory, but may we make an impact in this community for Jesus Christ. And may many people in the coming weeks and months and years come into a saving relationship with Jesus and come and join this church and become disciples. Amen.
What a great day. Wasn't that a super sermon? I want to clap for that. Man, I'm ready to go. Praise the Lord. Did you know that Bob is Brett's father-in-law? You probably knew that. I just learned that. That's pretty cool. And Brett actually worked as an associate for him for how many years? 13? That's a long time, and you guys are still getting along. 13. So this is good news, that not only has God called you to this moment, but you also get along with your father-in-law, and these folks like you a whole lot, because otherwise they wouldn't be here. Well, Brett, would you please come forward? Dear brother, we have some vows that we ask you to take at this point in time. I know that you've taken these before, but this is a great opportunity to refresh
my memory.
Your memory and these vows. Brett, will you seek to be faithful and diligent in the exercise of all your duties as a Christian and as a teaching elder, whether personal or interpersonal, private or public, and to endeavor by the grace of God to adorn the profession of the gospel in your manner of life, and to walk with exemplary piety before the congregation of which God is making you overseer?
I will.
Are you now willing to accept the call of this church as associate pastor and relying upon God for strength, promise to discharge to it the duties required of that office? Will you?
I will.
Praise the Lord.
If they'll have me.
I think they will. Well, praise the Lord. And so now, Jim, will you come forward, please?
Joyce.
Yeah. Oh.
If you would please stand. Questions to the congregation. Are you, the members of this congregation, ready to receive Brett Everett as your associate pastor? If so, please say, "We are."
We are.
Do you promise to submit to Brett Everett in matters of spiritual discipline and to receive with humility and love the word of truth? If so, please say, "We do."
We do.
Do you promise to support Brett Everett with your prayers, to give encouragement and assistance in every way as Brett seeks to instruct you in the things of the Lord and to lead you in the building of the kingdom of God in this place? If so, please say, "We do."
We do.
Do you commit yourselves to fulfill the terms of the call you have extended and to make provision for Brett Everett's needs that the name of Christ might be glorified? If so, please say, "We do."
Thank you.
This time the congregation may be seated, and I invite to come forward all elders, teaching elders, pastors, Bob, to come forward for the laying on of hands. And if his family want to come forward as well and lay hands as well. Let us pray. God our Father, we thank you for calling Brett Everett to the office of teaching elder in the church. In obedience to your calling, we by hand lay hands on Brett and install him to this office. We pray that you will fill him freshly with your Spirit and enable him to faithfully serve you and the people to whom you have given him charge. Through the name of the Good Shepherd, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we praise you, Father, and give you all glory for bringing him and his family to us. In your providence, you foresaw this moment. You knew its destiny and its inevitability because you had ordained it as you have ordained him. And so now, by the power of the Holy Spirit and your effectual call upon his life and ours, we install him as our associate pastor. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may stand. Brett, if you'll remain, I have one more thing.
Thank you, David.
By the authority of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church and the Presbytery of the West, I declare that Brett Everett has been duly and properly installed as associate pastor of this congregation, agreeable to the Word of God and the laws of the church. As such, he is entitled to be given support, encouragement, honor, and obedience in the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Brother Brett, every time I reach 2 Timothy chapter 4, I tremble. It begins this way. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. As I think about these words, I am led to give you four charges. First, I would charge you to teach and to preach the Word of God with not just a convinced heart, a convicted heart. Preach and teach with passion. People are hungry these days for pastors who stand for what is good and right. May your blood bleed, may your veins bleed with Bible. May you study it, saturate yourself in it, be utterly convinced of it, and teach it well. Psalm 119, verse 11, that's 11911, that is the emergency verse. And it says, I have treasured your word in my heart, Lord, that I may not sin against you. Good words, dear brother, good words. We live in an age where many pastors fail and fall, but may you stand firm on the Word of God. And may you always remember the great commandment, which is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself, of course, the second commandment. So I secondly charge you to lead with strength and patience, two things that are very important in showing the love of God to a congregation. You'll know, you already know a lot. I know that. You've been in ministry a long time. You've been in the School of Hard Knocks as well as a few other schools. But sheep need to be led. You know this, not pushed. And that shepherd's staff is not to beat the sheep with. It's to chase the wolves off. And believe me, there are lots of wolves out there who would love to see your congregation devoured. Let the love that you have for the Lord spill over into the hearts of the people that you are called to lead with Jim. Philippians chapter 2 reminds us that we are to consider others better than ourselves. Sometimes that's hard for a bunch of pastors with an ego, a, mile wide and an inch deep. No, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about those other pastors out
right
there. Third, I would encourage you to be sober-minded. It's not wise to drink whiskey before breakfast. But a ministry that is untethered to humility can become intoxicating. And as intoxicating as alcohol or sex outside of marriage. Oh, dear brother, I pray that you will be a model of spiritual integrity. We won't be perfect. None of us will be until that day that the Lord calls us home. But stand for what is right and good and noble and just and beautiful in the sight of the Lord. We need that. The church needs that. The people of this country need that. And fourthly, resolve to know nothing except Christ and Him crucified. Do the work of an evangelist. Be prepared in season and out of season to give an answer for your faith. Proclaim the gospel boldly. Churches are dying for pastors to set an example of being willing to spread the good news without reserve. And be joyful in it. You know what's really amazing to me? Is I find people, churches, getting really excited. And people who don't even go to church, they get excited when they hear a pastor who not only believes with conviction, but man, has a joy in his heart that doesn't quit. Let it flow, brother. And now to bring us back to the Frozen Chosen. John Calvin reminds us that the gospel will not maintain its place if pastors do not urge it earnestly. I'll let you figure that one out. But dear brother, I would charge you to keep your eyes fixed upon Jesus, to love Him passionately, love these people passionately, and to love Scottsdale and the surrounding area in a way that they say, oh, yes, Jesus, I want to fix my eyes upon you too.
Amen.
Today, as you know, we gather together to celebrate the installation of Brett Everett as our associate pastor. In preparing for this charge to the congregation, I sought out the definition of pastor. Here are some adjectives according to the web that describe a pastor: trustworthy, eloquent, caring, integrity, beloved, worthy, honest, accountable, credible, moral, unquestionable character, and we could go on. A pastor is also a spiritual leader. What characteristics must a spiritual leader possess? Effective communication, decision maker, self-awareness, self-esteem, ability to promote and engage in healthy conduct, the ability to explain and promote the Trinity, God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, and that list could continue. Brett Everett is all of that and more. Brett embodies the very definition of a pastor. We charge this congregation to continue to give Brett the freedom to be visionary and the permission to lead. Please remember that our vision comes from God. May we work together, be open to Brett's new ideas, give space so the Holy Spirit can work, create an atmosphere that minimizes stress and minimizes unrealistic expectations. Allow time off for relaxation and restoration. All ministers need time away with their families, as well as alone time with God. We charge you to care for his family. Don't expect his family to be any more perfect than yours, and recognize that every family is unique. Encourage Brett to make his family a priority and encourage him to devote the time and effort and energy required to keep them healthy. It's also important for you to write a note of appreciation from time to time, either a handwritten note or an email or even a text. We have witnessed his encouragement to all of us, so let's not forget to encourage him. It's a two-way street. Let him know the ways that God has used him in your life. Be specific and real. By that, I mean compliment him on his sermons, but don't just say, great sermon. Tell him specifically why it moved you or what resonated with you. Remember, we are all called together as the body of Christ for God's great purposes. Brett is not a proxy for your work. God doesn't need a fan club. God needs workers in the vineyard. Paul reminds us in Ephesians, there is one body and one spirit, and each of us was given Christian gifts. Some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, not for personal glorification, but so the saints would be equipped for the work of ministry for the building up of the body of Christ. Ephesians 4. Our community needs to know God's love and grace through each of you. This is a partnership of people and pastors on behalf of a mighty and merciful God. Please pray for Brett and continue to pray for Brett.
I want to thank the commission for their work, their energy, their effort in being here, and obviously they put a lot of thought, a lot of heart into all the words and every action, everything that they did. I want to thank Cliff and Tim. I want to thank Barb and Joyce. I want to thank Dave and Bob and Nathaniel for being a part of this commission, and to let you know your work is done. You are dismissed. Amen. Brett, it's great to have you on board. It is an honor to have you as an associate. It's more of an honor to have you as a friend. It's even more of an honor to have you as a brother in Christ. So I love the fact that you're honest, that you're real, and you have no problem to tell me, I think you're wrong. So, you know, you need that. The best support is not the person who says yes. It's the one that says, I think you need to rethink that. So it's really great to have this relationship and to have the honesty and the freedom and the flexibility to be together. We are an amazing team, and I know that God's brought us together. Great things are lying ahead because this is an amazing congregation, and you all are fabulous. What God is going to continue to do through us, we haven't seen anything yet. So stay open, stay connected, and stay ready to serve, because God's doing great things. Brett, I want to invite you to come forward and just sort of share before we go to song.
I'll make this brief because there are cookies. Yes. I like those cookies too. Church, friends, family, I am just deeply humbled. That's all I can say. I am proud of all of you. I'm proud to co-labor with all of you in Christ. And I'm just so excited to see what the Lord is doing. Tomorrow will be 3 years here for me on this campus. Can you believe it? It seems like 10 minutes sometimes. It's been so fun and just so neat to be able to minister alongside each of you. You have a great staff. You have a great senior pastor who supports and encourages. He's never been wrong, by the way, so that never did happen. But I'm just delighted. And I can't thank you enough for allowing me to be a part of this family. It's a great family. And I agree with you, Jim. I think the best is still before us. It's so exciting to see what God is doing, to see the energy that is here, the passion, the love for Christ, and the desire just to stretch ourselves and to do great things for Him. And so I know in the weeks and months and years ahead, it's only going to get better from here. And I'm just delighted to be a part of that, to be a part of the ride with you, but always to give all glory and all honor to Jesus Christ, for it's Him who deserves it, and not me and not us. We are just part of the family, doing what He's asked us to do as those who are called and equipped. Thank you so very much. Thanks for being here too.
If you are able, will you please stand and let us join together in our closing hymn, Here I Am, Lord.
Brett to come forward. Our coronation is not complete without some bling.
Oh my. a really big ring.
You? Oh my.
And now it's time for the benediction.
Now it's time for the benediction. I'm going to take this off before it falls off through the benediction. My head's too big. Yeah. Folks, thank you again for being here. And I just want you to know we are called and equipped, as Bob said. And I'm ready if you are. I'm ready to change the world. And I know you are too. So let's just go out there and do that. To that end, remember this. You go nowhere by accident. Wherever you go, God is sending you. Wherever you are, God has put you there. God has a purpose in your being there. Christ lives in you and has something he wants to do through you where you are. Believe this and go in the grace and love and power of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.